Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Melanie Duvall, and I'm the Senior Vice President and Chief Philanthropy Officer at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and the Jimmy Fund. And I'm honored to welcome you to today's webinar. This afternoon, we're here to celebrate the long-standing relationship that our Jimmy Fund community has had with the Boston Red Sox, a partnership that is more than 67 years long and still going strong. While baseball season will look a little different this year, the Jimmy Fund's partnership with the Red Sox allows all of us to team up, come together as a community, and strike out cancer. Before we get started with our webinar, I just wanted to go over a few housekeeping items, please. Please note that all the attendees are currently on mute and their cameras are turned off to ensure that everyone can adequately hear the program. If you have questions throughout today's program, we welcome and encourage you to use the Q&A icon on your screen. All submitted questions will be sent directly to me, and we'll have time to answer as many of those questions as possible after we hear from each presenter. And with Larry and Sam and Dr. Diller on this webinar, I think there are going to be some great questions this afternoon. I'd like to begin by thanking all of you for joining us today and for your loyal partnership and support of Dana-Farber and the Jimmy Fund. We're truly grateful for your support now more than ever, and your generosity is at the heart of everything we do for our patients and for our families. As we know, cancer does not wait while the world responds to the coronavirus pandemic, and neither are we. Thanks to the philanthropic support from dedicated donors like you, we've been able to mount a response to COVID-19 that ensures superior care with the proper safety protections for today's patients and the continuation of cancer research that will lead to tomorrow's cures. On a personal level, this Jimmy Fund community inspires me each day in my work, whether it's at the Institute or from my home office. And I've worked in philanthropy for my entire career and for some really remarkable organizations, but I could not be more proud to work at Dana-Farber, especially during the last 4 months when the community has come together and gone above and beyond to respond to and care for our patients during this incredible crisis. I can tell you that the tremendous partnership that exists between the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund is beyond compare. It's one of the most historic partnerships in all of baseball, all of Major League sports, and we are so proud and honored to be partners with this incredible organization. Begun in 1953, this partnership has been the most long-standing, visible, and successful relationship between any charity and a sports team in the history of professional sports. The impact of that partnership can be seen and felt in every aspect of our life-saving work at Dana-Farber. Whether it's visiting the pediatric and adult patients or helping to raise funds for cancer care and research, the Red Sox have always been champions for the Jimmy Fund and for Dana-Farber. Together, the Boston Red Sox, the Red Sox Foundation, and the Red Sox Nation have helped raise more than $150 million for the Jimmy Fund. I just want to say that I've been delighted to have known Larry Lucchino and gotten to know Sam Kennedy and other members of the Red Sox organization, and inspired by their continued commitment to Dana-Farber and their continued commitment to the Red Sox and the Red Sox Nation. And I look forward to hearing more about that from Larry and Sam in a few minutes. To celebrate this powerful partnership together, we have a terrific program planned today. And first, we're going to hear from Dr. Lisa Diller. She is joining us with this perspective that she has. It is a unique perspective as the Chief Medical Officer of the Dana-Farber Boston Children's Cancer and Blood Disorder Center. And she'll give you an insider's look into our pediatric side of our care at Dana-Farber. We have and will continue to offer other webinars that go into detail on many specific aspects of their adult care oncology that we're providing and the successes in our research breakthroughs and enterprise as well. But today's conversation is going to focus on our pediatric patient care and Dr. Diller's experience. After Dr. Diller, we're going to add in conversation about the history of the partnership between the Jimmy Fund and the Boston Red Sox with Larry Lucchino and Sam Kennedy, two all-stars who have played leading roles in deepening this connection. At the end of the program, we'll have time for audience Q&A with our panel, and I look forward to some great questions. Now, I have the great privilege of introducing Dr. Diller. Dr. Lisa Diller is the Chief Medical Officer of the Dana-Farber Boston Children's Cancer Center and Blood Disorder Center. She sees the importance of the relationship between the Boston Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund firsthand with our youngest patients. Lisa, thank you so much for joining us today. I think you're on mute, Lisa.
Sorry about that. We're still getting used to Zoom. Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction, and I'm thrilled to be here today. I thought what I'd do, first of all, to thank you for being here, tell you a little bit about pediatric cancer and a little bit about me, tell you about the Jimmy Fund Clinic, and tell you how the partnership between the Jimmy Fund Clinic and the Red Sox truly improves outcome for children with cancer. I've been at the Dana-Farber my entire career. I did a pediatric training at Boston Children's Hospital, inspired by the oncologist who taught me pediatrics. I decided to be a pediatric cancer doctor and did my fellowship training at the Dana-Farber and Boston Children's, and have been a member of the faculty for 30 years. I've witnessed the changes over time and the strength of the relationship between the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund Clinic is one of the pleasures of my career. I have a picture here to show you. First, look up at the upper right. I think my arrow works. That's me seeing a patient. I take care of mostly very young children with cancers that occur in the first few years of life. They're called embryonal cancers. They're cancers that really don't occur in adults. They occur in tissue that's part of embryonic development before birth, and in some children develop into cancers after birth. We've made remarkable improvements in pediatric cancers over the years, as you can see in this slide. That's just showing the proportion of kids who survive. Before I started my career, those numbers were difficult to deal with. Doctors routinely went to the emergency room to see patients and parents with the diseases that I now treat, telling parents that we had very little to offer. That has changed over the decades, so that now a child diagnosed with cancer walking into the emergency room today, has a greater than 80% chance of being cured of their cancer. If you look at the bottom right, you can see that there's truth, that I'm telling the truth, that the Red Sox has meant a lot to me personally. This is August of 2004. 25 of us docs got to throw out an opening pitch. I'm the lady with the left-handed lady with the Red Sox on throwing my pitch. And gotta say, one of the highlights of my career, and certainly my kids loved it. A little background on pediatric cancer. What you should know is that it's very rare. Children don't generally get cancer. Cancer is a disease of the aging. So when a child gets cancer, though it's rare, it's life-changing for the parents, for the family. Only about 10,000 children are diagnosed with cancer annually, but it is still the leading cause of death in children in the United States. And those improved outcomes I told you about, those have come with a ton of work by my colleagues to do research, by my colleagues in the clinic who provide multidisciplinary care, the nurses, the psychologists, the social workers, the subspecialists from other fields. And they've come because parents can get the kids the therapy they need. We have to support families. It's an incredible burden to have a child with cancer. And so to be able to make sure that we can get parents who may be challenged financially, who may be challenged by other hardship, we can get parents to bring their kids to the clinic, to get chemotherapy on time, to get surgery when they need it. That's something that we have, that has contributed to these great improvements. So what is the Jimmy Fund Clinic? For those of you who aren't familiar, here's a picture of some scenes. Whoops, I'm gonna go back one. Of some scenes in the middle here, this is the Binney Street, and the Jimmy Fund Clinic is right here in the Dana building, across the street from the Yawkey building, that where most of our adult cancer patients are taken care of. We try to make it kind of a fun place. It looks a little outer spacey here, places for people to play, colorful, interactive, where people can see each other. But it's not just a place, it's a place for people. These pictures here on the left were taken way before this fellow here on the right. He was wearing a mask before his time. These pictures here were taken recently during COVID, where everybody's wearing a mask, but you can still see the warmth coming through, that everybody, the nurses, the patients, the families, are all there for one purpose, and that's to get children treated for cancer successfully, and to make sure that when they're treated for cancer, their quality of life is as good as it can be. This picture in the middle is particularly special to me. This is a young girl and her younger brother. This young girl had cancer, and we were able to learn over the years that very rarely, less than 10% of the time, cancer runs in families and children. And her younger brother has the same risk that she does, but we were able to screen him and prevent his cancer from occurring because of the advances that we've made in understanding the genetics of cancer. So not only do we treat cancer and treat it with warmth and with our hearts, but we prevent cancer. And one of the things that the Red Sox have been able to do is to make the Jimmy Fund even more special. I think that every child with cancer needs their best shot at a good life. We can't cure everyone, but we can make everyone feel special, and the Red Sox have certainly done that. Our partnership with the Red Sox, the funds that are raised, the ways the players and the staff of the Red Sox go out for our patients, not only promotes research by funding research, not only offers patient and family support and supports multidisciplinary comprehensive care, but makes it a really special place where people are kind of happy to come even though they're getting cancer therapy. And if you see the smiles here, this is, I think, rookie day here on the left, when rookies come to the clinic and get pictures taken. Here you can tell what this day was, when the World Series trophies were coming around. And here's a very special event that's sponsored by the Red Sox and by the Jimmy Fund, where teenagers can go to spring training. They go down to Florida, they hang out with the players. They feel really sort of independent from their parents. They're teenagers, they have cancer. They don't really get to hang out with their friends very much and go to parties. But here they get their time away in a very special way. So that's just examples of how the Red Sox partnership with the Jimmy Fund kind of makes such a difference. You know, the funding that goes to research really does contribute to discovery. Here are three of my colleagues and a patient who are helping us understand the genetics of the tumors, helping to find new drugs, helping to do research to reduce the side effects of therapy, personalizing therapy by understanding the genetics, preventing in some cases, as I mentioned earlier, and providing safer ways of delivering therapy like radiation. Funding from the Red Sox from the Red Sox Foundation and from donors like you have supported this kind of research and contributed to the improvements in care that we've experienced. And here's a very special patient to me. His name is PJ. And PJ had osteosarcoma. He unfortunately succumbed to his disease, and late in the course of his illness, he spent a fair amount of time lying in bed on a stretcher because he couldn't sit up. And this is October 2018 World Series. He got to go to the game with his dad. I'll try to read something to you that he wrote in a blog, which his parents gave permission to share with you. He said, going to the game was awesome. They were able to bring me right in on my stretcher, so I didn't have to worry about sitting up in a wheelchair. And they rolled me right up against the railing where I could see everything. The atmosphere was amazing. I tried to focus on soaking it all in. The game went back and forth, and it didn't really occur to me that we were going to win until Eduardo Nunez hit the home run. Then Craig Kimball came in and got that last out, and they started playing dirty water. It finally hit me. We had won a World Series game, and I was at the game. It was surreal. I was diagnosed with osteosarcoma in August of 2016, and like right now, I don't have the greatest diagnosis, but I'm in the best hospital in the world. I've also met some of the Red Sox players and went to a World Series game. Most people never get to do that. Paul had a great life. I loved knowing him. The Red Sox helped him a lot. That kind of partnership is precious, and I'm grateful for it. So the telethon and the radio telethon and raising money for the Red Sox just is so important. I hope I've given you a flavor for that. It's a weird time right now. We can't really do the radio telethon like we did. We can't all get together in groups. It's even weird seeing faces without masks on like this. But, you know, this is a view from the Jimmy Fund Clinic down to the floor in front of the Yawkey building or in front of the Smith building. And here you can see Dana-Farber. You can see Dana-Farber and Jimmy sitting there. And Lisa Sherber, who's our play lady, she and her group wrote a note to everyone in the Jimmy Fund Clinic who had to wear masks. The note says, laugh with your eyes, hug with your soul, and smile with your heart. That's our motto in this COVID time, and the Red Sox help us do that. So thank you to the Red Sox, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Lisa. Your team's hard work and your unwavering dedication to providing the very best care for our patient inspires us all, especially and now more than ever. Now, I'd like to turn to the next part of our program and have a conversation about the historic partnership between the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund and the deep connection that is like no other in professional sports. And before we get started, I thought it would be fun to share with all of you the new visual identity of the Jimmy Fund that we launched in the new decade at the beginning of this year. So let's take a few minutes to watch this short video, which provides a look at the evolution of the Jimmy Fund's past identities. You could just play the video, please. Fantastic. As you can see, the Jimmy Fund brand has changed a lot over the years, and the Red Sox have been standing by our side every step of the way. I now want to introduce two more of our guests. They are Larry Lucchino and Sam Kennedy, who will join Dr. Diller and me for our discussion about the unique partnership we're celebrating today and every day. So I'd like to start with Larry Lucchino. Larry Lucchino is the chairman and principal owner of the Pawtucket Red Sox. He is the president and chief executive officer emeritus of the Boston Red Sox. He is a three-time cancer survivor, a Dana-Farber trustee, and chairman of the Jimmy Fund since 2016. And Sam is the president and CEO of the Boston Red Sox, the chief executive of Fenway Sports Management, and a Dana-Farber trustee as well. Larry and Sam, thank you both for being here today during a really busy time and for your leadership in strengthening the deep connection between the Red Sox and the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and the Jimmy Fund. If I could just ask if you have opening comments before we dive into some questions, we'd be happy.
Sam always has opening comments, but before he does, I want to say one thing, and that is how proud I am to hear Lisa Diller and to hear you, Melanie, describe the history of the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund and Boston. We're all part of one large fabric, and a sports team is nothing unless it fits into that community, fits into that fabric. And because of the utterly unique relationship between the Jimmy Fund, Dana-Farber, and the Red Sox, we have been able to do that full well. And Sam and I are just the latest custodians of a long tradition, a long history. It goes back to before 1953, frankly, and goes back to players like Ted Williams and Tom, and owners like Tom Yockey and Bobby Doerr and Dom DiMaggio and Yaz and Jim Lomborg, Bob Stanley, Mo Vaughn. It'd be impossible to list all of the Red Sox who have been part of this tradition. Suffice it to say that it has been our honor to help the Jimmy Fund in its research, its treatment, its prevention of cancers. And while there is a misconception out there that the Jimmy Fund is exclusively a fund for pediatric oncology, it also extends to adults like me and to other people. And no one, Sam, would call me young, would they? I don't think so. No. But in any event, we are proud to be part of a celebration. Melanie said that at the beginning, that this was a celebration and a thank you. We want to emphasize both of those things. We are proud. I mean, I can't tell you, if I were part of another sports team and didn't have the connection to an opportunity provided by the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund, I would feel less fulfilled, considerably less fulfilled. Because the role of the Jimmy Fund, which has been described as the people's charity of Boston, and it really is the people's charity, and the Red Sox have played a massive role over the last 7 decades to advance the Jimmy Fund. But it is really you people on the call who deserve to be thanked. You are the ones who step up, who do the work, who raise the money, to take the steps that are necessary to make Dana-Farber a more effective institution. And make no mistake about it, it is considerably more effective than it was when this relationship started in 1953 formally. So I think I speak for Sam as well, that one of the great joys of being a custodian of the Red Sox is the good work that can be done through the Red Sox for the cancer world of Boston and the world, frankly, for that matter. The Jimmy Fund is largely local, but not exclusively. It has a statewide constituency, is it a regional consistency, and we'd like to see it expand to a national and international consistency. In any event, we are really pleased to be here. And if we can answer any questions about the depth of the relationship, if you can't hear it in my voice, I wish you could, that there is a commitment on the part of people associated with the Red Sox that goes to the Jimmy Fund, that goes to Dana-Farber, that goes to fighting this miserable frickin' disease. And I think that we are lucky to have the vehicles and the history and the traditions and the opportunities that so many of you have provided to us to help us research and treat this disease over the years. So thank you very much. I know it was one of the first things we did when we bought the team in late 2001 was to take literally in the first week of our ownership, we went over to the Jimmy Fund and Dana-Farber so that I could introduce my partners, John Henry, Tom Werner. And by the way, Michael Gordon has done an extraordinary job for the Jimmy Fund, to be sure, over the years. But we wanted to establish right away that there would not be a step missed in the work going on between the Red Sox and the Dana-Farber and the Jimmy Fund. And the fact that I am currently chairman of the Jimmy Fund is a point of enormous personal pride. And I thank all of you for helping that title mean something.
Thanks, Larry. Thank you so much. And we can hear it in your voice.
Well, I guess that gives me the unenviable task of following Larry, which I would normally say, you know, it's really hard to do, but since I've been doing it my whole professional life, it actually isn't that hard. I've kind of gotten used to following Larry and following in his footsteps. Many of us went out to San Diego, sight unseen, to go work for Larry at the San Diego Padres. And then many of us from Boston, especially, followed him back east like little puppy dogs to come to the Boston Red Sox. And I would just add that for those of us who are from here and grew up here, there was no more demonstration of Boston sensibility that Larry displayed when the first act was to get to the Jimmy Fund and the Dana-Farber that first week in February of 2002 when the deal closed. And we've sort of come full circle here. I grew up within a half a mile of the clinic and used to walk by the clinic on my way to Red Sox games. In the 1980s, I had no idea, but up there and at Dana-Farber, Larry was actually being treated for cancer. He's had several bouts, and without the Dana-Farber, we actually wouldn't be here because it saved Larry's life. And of course, Larry put us all together in the 1990s and then brought us together in 2001 to join the Red Sox. So it's been just a magical ride. We're in our 19th year now with the privilege of being associated with the Red Sox. Those 19 years, there's been no deeper community connection than that of the connection between the Dana-Farber and the Jimmy Fund. And I'll just end by saying, Larry said it well, we are just stewards of this particular moment in time. We're approaching 70 years of a partnership, and it was here long, long before us, and will continue and survive long beyond our time in Boston. But it is a privilege and an honor to be associated with the Dana-Farber, and to Dr. Diller and all of your colleagues and teammates. We are so appreciative of the work that you guys do each and every day, the life-saving work. It's incredibly special. We've developed so many relationships with doctors, but also patients over the years, and it's just been incredibly powerful for all of us here at Fenway Park. So thanks to everybody there that is associated with this great institution.
Hey, Sam, will you forgive me if I tell the story of getting you back to Boston? We bought the team at the end of 2001 in December, and then we proceeded to hire a few people who were instrumental in our previous successes, and it would do great in Boston. But I couldn't get the owner, my partner in San Diego, to release two people. One was Sam Kennedy, and the other was Theo Epstein, and he was willing to give me permission to take other people if they wanted to come to Boston, but he would not release those two, perhaps because of the good judgment he had with respect to their high ceiling and long-term potential. Anyway, we organized a group called Free the Brookline 2. Sam was one, and Theo Epstein was the other. And I wrote him on stationery saying, we need to free the Brookline too and let them come back home to the institutions and the team that they knew. And after a few months of nearly ceaseless hammering, he said, okay, we'll free the Brookline too. And so they came back there. And of course, Sam has been with the team and done a wonderful job with the team for almost 20 years now.
Oh, that's a great story. Free the Brookline too. I'm gonna hang on to the question about what Sam's been doing with and talk a little bit more about baseball in a minute. I can't wait, Sam, to dive into that. And I wanted to start though back to Lisa for a minute because because we had a couple of questions that came up from the people who are on the webinar, Lisa, about the, you know, the Jimmy Fund clinic and taking care of little ones during the COVID-19 pandemic. So could you share just a few specific examples of how Dana-Farber really pivoted and ensured that each of our patients, especially the kiddos, were able to come in and have their treatments, and now maybe what you see on the horizon as we're moving forward?
Sure. So as you mentioned, Melanie, you know, the main focus when we were dealing with COVID was making sure that the children who needed life-saving chemotherapy, and I should say the adults who needed life-saving chemotherapy as well, could continue to safely receive that chemotherapy. And we put all our efforts into making sure that that was done and done safely. We also pivoted to be able to provide Zoom-based care or telemedicine, telehealth, and rapidly learned how to take care of patients and assess patients from afar in ways that have proved to be pretty efficient and that many people seem to like a lot. So where do we go going forward? Let me just say that it turns out that kids, as you've probably read, don't get very severe COVID. Younger children tend not to end up with really bad pulmonary disease, respiratory problems, needing to be in the ICU. We've had 7 positive cases of Jimmy Fund Clinic patients. They've all done very well. We're testing everybody who needs to be admitted or needs to have anesthesia or other or has symptoms, and our test rate is very, very low. And we've had no nurse to patient or doctor to patient transmission. So we feel like we've done a really good job at protecting our patients as well as protecting our healthcare providers. Going forward, we're, you know, in a wonderful place in Massachusetts right now, fingers crossed, knock on wood, that we stay that way. And we're being very, very cautious and careful, not letting up at all. We're continuing, myself and all my colleagues, to work virtually unless we absolutely need to be in the hospital or in the clinic seeing a patient. So telemedicine, I think, is not going to go away, or at least for some time. And hopefully we'll learn how to use it to help families and help patients deal with the burden of cancer by receiving what might be more convenient care, even when COVID has passed into a distant, nasty memory and we don't have to think about it anymore.
Great, thank you, Lisa. Thanks very much. Larry and Sam, there are 2 questions here, and I'm gonna start with Sam. Sam, the question is about Mitch Moreland, and Mitch is the new Jimmy Fund team captain. And are there any plans about his role, or and again, as you look ahead at what the new season might look like and how the relationship between the Jimmy Fund and the Red Sox might take shape, and especially with Mitch in this new role? And then Larry, I'll ask you for some comments as well.
Yeah, well, thanks for pointing out our new captain. Unfortunately for Mitch, trying to follow Brock Holt as the Jimmy Fund captain is like trying to follow Larry Lucchino as CEO of the Red Sox. It's an impossible task. And in fact, when I spoke to him about it, I actually gave him that example. And I said, look, you know, you had Mayor Menino in Boston, and Marty Walsh tried to follow him. Marty Walsh called me when I tried to follow Larry Lucchino, and he said, hey, just be yourself. You're never going to be someone you're not. You can never, I don't think anyone could ever appropriately follow Brock Holt. This guy did more in just our time here for the Jimmy Fund, the connection. It was so genuine and real. And Brock, I think, honestly, one of the things he was most upset about leaving the Red Sox was that connection between the Dana-Farber and the Jimmy Fund. So on behalf of the Red Sox, we are sorry to let Brock go. We will miss him personally. But Mitch Moreland is a big, gigantic human being, and he's got an equally big heart. He was born in Mississippi and has learned this incredible connection between the fan base and the team, and he knows that the Jimmy Fund is at the heart of that, and so he is excited to try and carry on the tradition that Brock and so many players before, whether it was Tim Wakefield or right. others that have been so involved. Mitch is ready to step up, and I just hope we can all get back to a place where we're able to do in-person visits, because there's nothing more powerful for our players and our staff than actually going to the clinic and hanging out with Lisa and the crew. And so hopefully we can get back there in person. But Mitch was really honored by this, and having a captain was an idea that Larry started many years ago. And I think it really amplifies the partnership when you get the players personally involved. So I know Mitch is excited about it.
Great. Thank you. We're excited about it too. And well said, we will miss Brock. Larry?
Well, I think the whole concept of the Jimmy Fund captain has grown since 2010. And I think that Mitch Moreland is a very worthy custodian of that rank and opportunity. And what it was intended to do was to be sure that there was a player or two on the team who felt a primary connection to the Jimmy Fund. So if no one could be found to do this or to do that or to help support this, we could go to the team captain and count on them. Now, it's proven to be a great idea if you go all the way back to Tim Wakefield, as Sam said, and to Clay Buchholz. There are a number of people that have occupied this position, but Brock Holt is the guy who won the trophy for sure. And I think it's a great thing. And I would say one thing that we probably didn't need as much as I thought. A person who felt deeply connected to the Jimmy Fund, because so many of our players walk in the door with their arms open, say, what is this I hear about the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund? What's this I hear about the Red Sox and the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute? And so many of them are so receptive to the needs that the Jimmy Fund has, be it for a celebrity speaker or for a person to visit the clinic or whatever it may be, that we're lucky to have captains as dedicated as we have had. But the fact is that it's almost a rite of passage. If you're going to play for the Red Sox, if you're going to have your name on a Red Sox roster, you're going to do something during your time here to help advance the Jimmy Fund, Dana-Farber, because there's nothing more important than preventing and treating and curing this miserable disease. And I think our players feel that fairly well.
Absolutely. And that's one of the things that is so special about that relationship. And we look forward to generations of that continuing. And as I talked earlier at the beginning of our conversation and the funds that have been raised through this partnership, I would be remiss if I didn't actually add to the fact that not only is the Red Sox community and the Jimmy Fund growing together over the years, but we've also added the PMC and the members of Team 9 who are even today virtually training and riding as the upcoming PMC in its reimagined shape is taking form in about a month from now. And so I think it's great that
we at the Red Sox love the Pan Mass Challenge, Saint Billy Starr, as we call him. He is an extraordinary visionary, and what he has done is just extraordinary. And we were proud to help transition the PMC for something a little more cult-like to something a little more broad-based and middle of the road kind of thing. And it's a point of real pride for us.
We have a saying at Fenway Park about the great Billy Starr: you cannot contain him.
Yeah, exactly right.
You definitely cannot stop him. He is a force of nature, and we're so, so proud to be affiliated with Billy and Meredith and everybody at the Pan Mass. I actually think he's responsible for 6 or 7 marriages in the Red Sox front office. He seems to be a matchmaker, volunteers, interns, and he's just a force. And we need more leaders like him in our community. He is just so passionate about this this event that raises so much money for Dana-Farber and the Jimmy Fund. And the Red Sox are proud to support that event as well. And for all you folks out there, please get involved. It's much easier to be. I've been a real rider and a virtual rider. It's much easier to do it virtually, I can assure you.
We're going to talk about that after the PMC weekend, Sam. So I'll get back to you on that. And I'll say a couple other things about some of our other events at the end of the conversation. But now, Sam, I think one of the things that we're all interested to know is, tell us about what the season might look like. And it's going to be a really remarkable season this year. And so many of our Jimmy Fund community of supporters really love the opportunity to go to Fenway, myself included, and raise money and tip into the Jimmy Fund cans and boxes at Fenway. Then what does the season look like from your vantage point that you can share?
Well, it's been a, as Larry can attest, it's been a long grind here for so many. The devastating impact of this virus have been felt everywhere. And in our little corner of the world, the baseball business, unfortunately, has been just about as hard hit as any industry. We had to shutter our spring training operation back March 12th down in Florida. And we're only recently back here at Fenway Park, just a skeleton crew. We began our medical intake process yesterday. So Major League Baseball mercifully was able to finalize negotiations with the Players Association to get the framework of an agreement in place to have what we hope, fingers crossed, a 60-game season, which will begin on July 23rd or 24th. We don't have a final schedule yet. To think that we're here on June 30th and we don't have our schedule for the 2020 baseball season has really made this unprecedented. But I think that the consistent message we've heard from elected officials and leaders around town and around the country, frankly, is that we need live sports. It is important for our sense of normalcy and to give us some sort of distraction from what's going on around us. So we're hopeful to start spring training this Friday. We're going to have spring training here in Boston at Fenway Park. We're calling it summer camp, not spring training, but summer camp. And we're going to have training in Boston and in Boston College. And then we will play a 60-game schedule against the American League East and the National League East. We'll play 40 games within our division and 20 games against National League East opponents. And then we will have a quote-unquote normal postseason. The format for the postseason will remain the same, and that will begin immediately following the completion, we hope, of the first 60 games. I can tell you your group will appreciate this in terms of understanding what goes into health and safety and medical protocols. We have a 120-page manual. Our testing is as robust as any other professional sports league on planet Earth. And we hope that we're going to be able to get through this safely and in a responsible way. But it we recognize it does come with significant risk. And it is a going to be a high wire act to try and get all of this in here. But we're hopeful we can do it. We're hopeful to get back on television at least. Thanks to the great work of Massachusetts citizens, the data here is incredibly positive.
How do you use that?
That comes in the backdrop of cases rising around the rest of the country. So it's a very, very difficult thing to try and play baseball across the country where you have cases rising. But thankfully in Massachusetts, everyone has done, our leadership has have done a great, great job. And I just hope that we can start to see leadership like that around the country because we are going the wrong direction with respect to different parts of the country. Another reason to be so fortunate to live here in Boston and in Massachusetts. So anyway, we will look forward to starting up in a couple of weeks, and we'll hopefully have some images coming out of Fenway Park soon where people can start to get excited about baseball, and the other sports teams will be starting up as well towards the end of the month. So it will be exciting to get live sports back, at least on television to start, and then maybe by the end of the season, knock on wood, fingers crossed, hopefully we could get maybe a couple thousand people inside of Fenway Park in a socially distanced manner while we work towards trying to live with this virus.
Those people can imagine how energizing and excited and ecstatic those people would be to come back to Fenway, even for one game, a couple thousand people be like winning the golden ticket. So it's a day that we all look forward to for sure. Larry, did you have any comments about what you see as the opportunity with the Red Sox in the shortened season? And I know, you know, we have also our new I Am Jimmy advertising that is hopefully going to introduce a new generation of supporters and families to the Jimmy Fund. And Sam has been kind enough to appear in one of those commercials as well as a few others. So do you have some comments about bringing the Jimmy Fund into the shortened season and maybe an I Am Jimmy Day?
Yeah, as proud as we all are about Boston and the Red Sox and the Jimmy Fund and Dana-Farber, we have an obligation. And that's, what's the old Bob Dylan line? If you're not being busy born, you're busy dying. And I think that it's important that we evolve the Jimmy Fund, that we grow it, that we get new people, new generations, younger people. All my adult life, I've known of the Jimmy Fund and the relationship it had with the Boston Red Sox, and I've admired it. And as I said, I think it was the Cardinal in Boston who called it the People's Charity. But I do think it's important that we change and grow and develop and expand and do things that are that show that the Jimmy Fund is a dynamic organization, not just a dry old tradition. And I think that that is the case. And the people on this phone call are among those people who are making it so, be they Jimmy Fund or Dana-Farber professionals, or be they volunteers, or be they people who organize, whatever. I would ask one thing in the spirit of the ever evolving, ever changing, ever growing Jimmy Fund, that we that each of the people on this call take some step when it's over, and not just the I certainly will remember the warm community feeling that I have on this call, because it is what the Jimmy Fund in Boston and Massachusetts provide us with. There is this warm sense that we're in this together and we're going to do important things together, and all that's right. But I would just ask that people take an individual step of some sort to do something to advance the cause. It can be writing a check, and it can be organizing an event. It can be calling a friend. It can be something. But let's don't sit back and let things evolve without our active enthusiasm and active participation. It is what we're doing is so important. I hope that we have succeeded in convincing you that not only is it important to the identity of who the Red Sox are, but it's important to this community that we pull together, work together. And I hope that after this call, people will take the initiative to do something. I don't care if you do it 10 minutes after this call or 10 weeks after this call, but do something to advance the Jimmy Fund and Dana-Farber and the cancer message that we are trying to bring about.
It's a call to action if I've ever heard one, Larry. I will. I'll do it. I promise. Okay. And at the end, we'll give some specific ways and one particular. But Lisa, before we get to a final closing remarks and some reflections, I just wanted to just been talking with by email with Sam Wisnia, who wrote the Jimmy Fund, you know, history book. And one of the first images in that book is Dr. Sidney Farber talking with a patient. And, you know, it all goes back to working with our adult and pediatric communities and our caregivers and our researchers to prevent and early diagnosis, prevention, and curing of cancer. And as you look at your career as a leader in cancer, pediatric cancer in particular, what are you excited about as you look at the future of the ability that we have to harness this amazing philanthropy, this incredible inflection point of technology and artificial intelligence? And what are you hopeful about as you look at the kids that you're treating in the clinic?
Well, Melanie, as you know, as some people on the phone may know, one of my other hats that I wear at the Dana-Farber is thinking about cancer survivors.
Yeah.
And in studying cancer survivors, children who beat their cancer but end up with health problems, or not, but end up needing care for the rest of their lives in light of having had cancer as a child. And, you know, in a lot of ways, the docs who came before me pioneered new drugs that we still use today, those chemotherapies that make you lose your hair and low blood counts and need intensive therapy. And if you ask me where I think the future will be, I think it will be that we'll get rid of those old drugs, and that we will be able to personalize cancer care for each individual child so that they're taking a medication that targets their cancer and keeps away from the side effect profile of targeting other tissues or other parts of their body. So I guess my excitement is that the quality of life of survivors will be different, and that we will be able to improve that over time because the research will bring us more and more targeted therapy that takes advantage of a person's own ability to respond to cancer through their immune system, or takes advantage of the wonderful genetic insights that we've developed in order to really target their therapy. What I thought you were gonna ask me and what I have to squeeze in is that when I was in the survivorship clinic one day, the nurse came in and said, "Hey, Jimmy's here." And I said, "Who?" And they said, "Jimmy." And I said, "What are you talking about?" So I was running a survivorship clinic. We were seeing, you know, 20-year-olds, early 30s maybe. And after that, we would pass people on to the adult side. But in walks this 50-year-old guy with his sister. And he says, "I'm Jimmy." And in fact, it was Einar Gustafsson, Jimmy. And he wasn't feeling so well. And we got him to the right place for what he needed. But I had the wonderful, remarkable, historic kind of connection between the past and now sitting here thinking about the future, having sort of met the old Jimmy. And now we're all Jimmy. So yeah, I just needed to tell that story.
That's a great story. And it's amazing. And it kind of goes back to where we all started. So I just want to say again, Larry and Sam, we are so, so grateful. And the entire Dana-Farber Cancer Institute community is so grateful for our partnership and for what Sam and Larry, you continue to be the stewards of. Not a day goes by that we aren't deeply, deeply grateful and proud of our extraordinary relationship and affiliation. Right.
The feelings go both ways, Melanie. I want to tell you, both Sam and I and the people in the Red Sox and Paw Sox organization are equally proud to have this opportunity to work with you and to do this important work. The feelings go both ways.
Well, thank you so much. And I just wanted to share in closing, Lisa, thank you for sharing your perspectives as someone who's on the front lines and who is a physician and takes care of, you know, what it is we are all united to do, which is to take care of our patients and families and who need us the most. And before we go, I just wanted to remind a couple of reminders is that not only is the Pan Mass Challenge coming up in a month, but we're also going to be walking from anywhere. The Boston Marathon Jimmy Fund Walk is also virtual this year and will take place from anywhere and everywhere on October 4th. And so get those tennis shoes out and start that walking training too, Sam. So we'll get to a triathlon one of these days. I know it. Lastly, I want to thank everybody who's on this webinar for participating and taking a few moments out of the day today to learn, listen, reflect, and hopefully be inspired. Please keep checking the jimmyfund.org webpage because we are adding more virtual events and fundraisers and opportunities to come together as a community, even though we're physically apart. And as I said at the beginning, we all know that cancer does not stop regardless of whether or not there is COVID, and we are not going to stop either. And so with your support, we will continue to navigate the current situation carefully and emerge even stronger and forge ahead together toward a cancer-free future. And thank you again, Sam, Larry, Lisa, everyone, and let's get back to some baseball soon. We'll be excited for that day in a couple of weeks, Sam, Larry, thank you. Have a good afternoon.
Play ball.
Yes.